says, just memory verse in Zechariah 4:10, Zechariah chapter 4, verse 10, small things marked the beginning of the work in the hand of Zerubbabel. If you read Zechariah 4:10, Zechariah 4:10 talks about the assignment that God has given Zerubbabel. It says, they shall rejoice and shall see the plummet in the hand of Zerubbabel. They shall rejoice and see the plummet in the hand of Zerubbabel. That's the memory verse. They shall rejoice and see the plummet in the hand of Zerubbabel. Now, what is a plummet? What does a plummet mean? What is that? What is that? Is that a Bible? What is it actually? What is a plummet? The word plummet means it's an instrument, right? It's like a plumbering tool. Plumbering, the English word from plumbering comes from the word plummet, right? A plummet, it means fall or drop straight down at a high speed. A steep and rapid fall or drop. That's what the English word calls it. But it is something that weighs down or oppresses a burden. Plumbed, to fall straight down. So that word plummet is also a definition it's a tool. Something, it's like an instrument, a weight to hold down something. A weight, it's like you say, like you have a straight line or your plumbing spanner, but it's something you use to drop things down, to hold things down. They shall rejoice and see the plummet in the hand of Zerubbabel. It's an instrument, plumbing. Plumbing. It's a tool used to put things down and fasten things to their place. That's what that definition of that instrument is. Now, it says, small things mark the beginning of the work in the hand of Zerubbabel, but none might despise it. For the Lord had raised up one who would preserve until the headstone should be brought forth with shoutings. Now, what is a headstone? A headstone is the completion of a project. It's the last stone you put on a building, upon a project, or whatever you're doing. That is one of the last thing you put. That's one of the last instrument, one of the last vice, one of the last tool you normally put when you about to seal up a job, seal up a work, seal something that you are working on. And that is what you use to conclude the project. I read. The plummet was in good hands. Yes, the comfort of every believer in the Lord Jesus. Let the work of grace be ever so small in its beginnings, the plummet is in good hands. A master builder, greater than Solomon, has undertaken the raising up of the heavenly temple, and he will not fail nor be discouraged till the topmost pinnacle shall be raised. Now, what we're getting from this study is that you and I, we are being built by God. We are a church. We're built with life living stone. God is the architect. A word just comes to my mind when Hebrews, Paul says that they were looking for a city whose builder and maker is God. Now, they were looking unto God, the architect. God has designed a project, and God was trying to complete that project. God was trying to complete that building. So God was putting that building in place. But God is doing a building with you and I. We are tools and vessels of honor. Well, in the hand of God, there are those that God will use as vessel of honor, and there are those of vessel of dishonor. We'll talk about that some other time. That actually it is you that really prepare yourself which kind of vessel that God will make of your life. You can be in the house of God, you can be in the church of God, and your heart is not right with God. So what are you doing? You're becoming a vessel of dishonor before God. The body of Christ, there are all kinds of vessels. But we are all stones living stones, the Bible says, that God is using to build a community of believers, a church. Now, because Jesus is the master builder and the plummet is in his hand, no matter how he picks up, for wherever he brings us out of the situations, there is enough grace. There is enough grace to cause us to arise. There's enough grace to lift us up from that situation we find ourselves. There is enough grace in God to bring us out and empower us to be equipped in him. So he says, now, because Jesus is the builder, he's not discouraged in working with your life. He's not discouraged in making sure you accomplish whatever he has designed you to do for his glory. He's never discouraged in lifting your life out of the shambles that you find yourself often. Let me read something here. If the plummet were in the hand of a merely human being, we might fear for the building, but the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in Jesus' hand. The works did not proceed irregularly and without care, for the master's hand carried a good instrument. Now, let me explain that. The work that God is doing in us, in our lives, in your life, is not done anyhow. God is productively working to transform your life. God is productively seeking ways to establish you and give you grace. Hallelujah. The works did not proceed irregularly and without care. It says, for the master's hand carried a good instrument. Had the works been hurriedly run up without the due superintendence, they might have been out of the perpendicular, but the plummet was used by the chosen overseer. Jesus is evermore watching the erection of his spiritual temple, that it might be built securely and well. We are for haste, but Jesus is for judgment. I love that line there. Don't know, sometimes we want God to do things quickly with us, even our ministry. Oh boy, I want God to do quickly things in this church, in this ministry. But for God's concern is different from my concern. I want to see growth, but God wants to see judgment. God wants to see something that will stand the trial of times. God wants to see in your life a character restoration, a character molding, certain things. There's certain breakthroughs and blessings that God will not release to you based on your personality. Pastor Commander was saying that, was making a point about something yesterday, if you understood what he was saying, which was so simple, that there was a guy who someone duped $40,000 in Cameroon, about 40 million Cameroon currency. And this individual was duped by this lady and says he wanted to go to Belgium and make him make money and whatever. But the lady used the money to open a new business for her own family. And she went abroad and she came from overseas and she was shipping stuff with this guy's money. And didn't want to pay this guy. For 9 months, this guy was walking barefooted. And this guy will come to church and open the church every day to pray. You see, when you are in problem, you always draw near to God. It's a human nature. But God doesn't want your life to be like that, that only problem will bring you close to him. It does not give God joy that problems will be what brings you senses. It does not give God honor that problem is what has to bring you to God. Well, when he brings us to God, God is happy still, but he begins to work in us. Now, if we choose not to learn, then we don't get out of that situation. So this man was coming to church every day, and Pastor Commando began to work with this man, praying with this man, using the legal authority he has, the connections he has, to see that this man gets justice. And he was telling me in detail yesterday, and then this woman, after a while, this woman's folks died. And she sneaked into the country, but not knowing that they had a warrant of arrest. Pastor Commando has secured a warrant of arrest for her when she comes to the country. So they picked her from the airport. They put her in jail. So you got to pay this guy's money before you go bury your father. Well, that's what the Bible talks. The Bible talks about if you have a creditor, you want to deal with them expediently. Or else if they go to court and you find guilty, you'll be thrown in jail until you pay all the money you ain't coming out. And that was the reality. And the woman, because she had money, she had business that he did with this guy's money. She was buying property, products and selling and not paying this guy. And so and but she had to pay. She paid every part of that money, every to the last letter to the guy. But when this guy received the money, this guy that was coming to church always to open the church door to pray, when he got these resources, this old money again, about 40, 20 million, take 20 million Cameroon francs, he stopped coming to church. He's not into the business again. He's now, having excuses why he can't come to church. So Pastor Commando was saying if he had known, he wouldn't have prayed for him. Because that would cause the guy have lost his soul. Except God touched the guy, something again happened. It means the guy was coming to God, but his heart was not really changed. And most of us are like that. We come to prayer. We want to pray. It's not that our heart is really changed. It's because of the problems we're going through. And when that problem is done, we run away from God. We say, God, bye-bye. I'll see you some other time. God, you know, I love you, God. I appreciate you, but I got so many things I want to do, God, and you are not on my radar. But that's not the way of God. That is not the way of God. Says Jesus is evermore watching the erection of the spiritual temple, that it may be built securely and well. We are for haste, but Jesus is for judgment. Hence, the failure of many, a flattering work, the overthrow of many, a glittering profession, is this, is that they are not willing for them to be laid up properly, built up properly, so they fail. They quit the work of God. It's not going their way. They're not seeing what they want. Oh, it's taking a long time. What's the use? Now, it is not for us to judge the lost church, since Jesus has a steady hand and a true eye and can use the plummet well. Do we not rejoice to see judgment left to him? It means God is going to judge us. We as a church, as a building being built by God, will be judged by God. We will be judged by God. And the Bible says, Paul says, every man will receive according to the workings of his own hands. The plummet was in active use. It was in the builder's hand, a sure indication that he meant to push on the work to completion. If you allow God to do something in your life, folks, God will complete every good work that he has started with you. Because he has the tool. He has the plummet in his hand and he's working it out in your life. But you have to cooperate with God. You have to allow God. The stone does not dictate to the builder. The stone surrender to the builder. I remember quite well some years ago. Years ago. And I've learned a very valuable lesson. I've learned, and Pastor Felicia can bear me witness to that. I don't have any sacred cow in my life. Whatever I'm doing, that thing is not my God. If God asks me to let go of that thing, I will let go of it. No matter what it is. No matter what it is. Folks, you must understand that until you are willing to let go of whatever you are pursuing, that thing becomes an idol. It doesn't make no difference. Sometimes God might ask you to go do missionary work somewhere, and you say, God, my wife, my children, my husband, I can't go. Well, you're not ready to serve God. It could be a productive thing you do. It could be a business. It could be a venture, and God may ask you, shut it down. Go do something else. You don't tell God, oh, no, I want to do this. This is what I'm going to do. I want to stick with this. It's a lie. You are not ready for God. I love music. I was, I was more a music producer when growing up in Europe. I had contract with Sony Music. I had a production studio with some German folks. The day God asked me, I mean, that was how I was feeding. That was my lifeline. I'm talking about almost 20-something years ago. 20 years or 18 years ago. I had the fear of God in me. After I backslided and came back to God, I compromised. I said, okay, now I'm not going to do ungodly music. I'm going to produce Christian music and God says no, you have to let go of it, every one bit of it. I had to let go. Well, it is God's talent, yes. It is God's gift, yes. But then God went to make, but now God says, okay, now you've been established. Now you can do it. You're in a great country, you know, America, gospel music is good, Christianity is a medium. Now you can do it. After how many years I've left it, God says, no, now, okay, now do it. Do gospel music. Now I know your heart is right. I've built your spirit. Of course, there's no way I can sing ungodly music. There's no way I will even dance to that tune. But if I pursue it then, I won't have the passion I have for God now. There are certain things God will say, let go. You see, you are a stone. The builder builds you. You don't build the builder. I want you to pray this morning. Oh God, that which you've begun in my life, take full control. That which you want to do with my destiny, I surrender my life to you. Tell him, say, Lord, you are the potter. I am the clay. Make me whatever pleases you. Tell God this morning, use me according as you seem fit. Somebody begin to pray with me this morning. Before we continue, begin to talk to God. Lord, make me as you seem fit, O God. Use me as you choose. Do what you want to do with my life. Let my life be something that is yielded to you totally. It is not in my hands. My whole destiny is not in my hands. It's in your hand. You are building me. You are directing me. You open my eyes, every form of idolatry in me, everything that I've held in high esteem above you, everything that I've put in place of you that I can't let go, oh God, oh God, oh God, today I surrender it. I surrender it. I surrender it. Le brosen dubran dobre zunda bababa sonda. Le brosan di boboshi. Mazoka le boboshi kababa zondo. Nipro zondo bondo blinda brondo boshi. Mazeko librando brinda bobosi nda baba. Le broson di brondi bobosi la baba baba shanda. Le prondo bobo bobosi nda. Masunda baba bazinda baba. Le prozondo brendo bobo bobo sika bondo bri. Mazo bondo brita le. Ori baba baba sham. Somebody begin to pray to God.
Entry tone off.
Talk to God, talk to God, talk to God. Let your heart be God. I yield my life to you. I yield my life to you. I yield my life to you. I yield my heart to you. Oh God, bring me to the place where I'm yielded to you. Bring me to that place where you have sovereignty in me. Bring me to that place where your glory reigns in me. In Christ Jesus' name, we pray. Somebody talk to him this morning. Say, Lord, every idol, everything that is before me that I've put above you, I let go. Let your perfect will be done. Let your perfect will be done. That my life can bring you glory. That my life can bring you honor. Lord, I live for you. I live for you and you alone. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I live for you and you alone. My whole heart is to give you glory. My whole world is to honor you. Blessed be your name. Thank you, Father. In Christ Jesus, we pray, and amen. Amen. This morning, I'm doing a series called The Offspring of God. The offsprings of God. The offsprings of God. What does that mean? Well, it means what it says. An offspring. What is an offspring? When you say someone is an offspring of something, what does it mean to be an offspring of something? What does it mean to say you're an offspring of I don't know, but what does it mean to say you're an offspring of so and so. All right. Now, an offspring means a product, an identical product, or a product derived from something, positioned and equipped to function in a specific way, like the original. More so, even often more better than the original. It means a creation from a creator. The word creator and creation are similar. It's only the I-O-N that separates the O-R. Creation is spelled C-R-E-A-T-I-O-N. Creator is spelled C-R-E-A-T-O-R. Now you can see that creator and creation are similar, but they're not the same thing. Creator and creation are similar, but they're not the same thing. So, Spirit of God, we ask for a fresh anointing. We ask for a fresh empowerment. We ask for a fresh grace. We ask for a fresh desire, even now, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, I want you to listen, to hear me very well, because this teaching has the power to change your whole world depending on your level of faith, depending on your level of spiritual maturity and spiritual growth. This teaching has the ability to reshape and reconjure your life worth and cause you to become worthful instead of being worthless person. There's many worthless people in life, many worthless pastors, many worthless Christians, many worthless prayer warriors, many worthless Bible believers, many worthless evangelists, many worthless apostles, many worthless prophetess, many worthless prophets, many worthless deacons, many worthless elders, many worthless Sunday school teacher, many worthless children's teacher. The Bible called them sons of Bela. Bela means worthless. God says they are sons of Bela. They are not useful to God. They may be of God, but they are not part of God. They are the sons of Esau, descendant of Edom. And because they are Edom, they are the wash basin of God. They have no use, of no importance, of no significant contribution to the race and the agenda of heaven. I want you to clean your ear from every wax this morning, people of God, because what you're about to hear is about to unlock your glory and cause you to become that which God has destined for your life. Hear me very well. Abraham had a son called Isaac. In the book of Genesis chapter 15 verse 3, Abraham's problem with God, or Abraham's desire for God, was an offspring. He was looking for an offspring. What it means, an offspring. Here is a man that has so much wealth, so much resources, so much servants, so much success, yet he did not have a son on his own. His servants have given birth to children in his household. But those, although they were still his slaves, but those were not his sons. He cannot commit his entire worth to strangers. Although they were born of his household, but they were still not his own seed. They were not from his own loins. So Abraham asked God a question. In Genesis 15 verse 3, Genesis 15 verse 3, then Abraham said, look, you have given me no offspring. Indeed, one born in my house. Indeed, one born in my house is my heir. Meaning, is it the servant that are born in my house? The one that were born in my house, my servants, are they going to be, they are not my heir, my inheritors? Says God, you've not given me an offspring. Why is he saying, God, you're not giving me an offspring? I'm trying to tell you, the offsprings of God is my teaching today. The most important thing, the valuable thing, what we call offspring, and how they play a role in your life. So Abraham is saying, God, man, you've blessed me in everything, but I don't have an offspring. So what I need most is an offspring. Understand where I'm heading to. So God told Abraham, this is what you're going to do. I'm going to bless you. And God gave Abraham a promise. So time, I'll make a seed out of you. I'll give you your own offspring that will look like you, that will continue my covenant with you for generations. God gave Abraham Isaac. You know Ishmael. Ishmael was not Abraham's offspring. Was a son of Abraham. But because the other root, Hagar, was not called out with Abraham. Hagar was given to Sarah by the Egyptians. And Hagar was no part of God's covenant. It was an Egyptian. And God called Abraham. And Abraham was married when God called her. So God wanted to use that same seed to bless Abraham. And of course, you know the miracle. Amen. Sarah was very old, yet God's faithfulness came to pass. So he had Isaac. Isaac had two children as well, Jacob and Esau. Now, I want to hear the reason why I say an offspring. As long as God was concerned, Esau was not part of God's inheritance. Oh, now you go, what? Esau is the grandson, the first grandson of Abraham. Of Abraham. Esau was born while Abraham was still alive. Abraham was not dead. Abraham was still alive when Isaac had Esau and Jacob. Yet, God was still saying, I can't deal with Esau. Esau cannot commit my blessing. That's why I told you that some people might be Christian, even a pastor, yet they are not the offspring of God. They may have a religious view, yet they are not the offspring of God. Because if you are God's offspring, you are like God. You behave like God. You operate like God. You do things like God. All right. Now you're getting what I'm saying, right? Because you are an offspring of God. So we have tried to identify to you what an offspring means. It's a creation by the Creator, from the Creator, for a specific purpose. The Bible says that Abraham had Isaac. Isaac had Jacob and Esau. Yet God chose Jacob rather than Esau. God has chosen you, yet you can choose not to operate in the anointing of the offsprings of God. Yes, God has called you. Yes, God has ordained you. Yes, God has showed you his love. But you can choose not to. Masuka. Ora baba baba basuntaba. Le ponto brunda baba basukaba. Le ponto brunda baba baba. Ora baba baba basutaba. Zuta bota brunda bresunda. Now, there's a covenant relationship in offspring, meaning whenever God enters into a pact with you, God has the future in mind. God has the future in mind. The Creator creates a creation. The creation has been designed to operate like the Creator. The creation has been designed to manifest like the Creator. You have been called out, you have been equipped, designed to function like God on the earth. That is God's intent in creating you. It does not change. It will not change. The Bible says that we have the mind of Christ. Well, you are having the mind of your Creator. When you begin to discover that we are the offspring of God, the way you behave differs, the way you pray differs, and what you believe God for differs. Now, let me share a scripture here, because I want you to... God will do whatever it takes to protect his offspring. There is nothing in the whole of creation that can ruin God's offspring, except the offsprings themselves deny God's ability in them. There's no circumstance, no challenge that you are going through that can defeat God's purpose in you, except you deny your rightship as an offspring of God. What am I saying? As an offspring of God, what do we have? An offspring means a product from you. Your children are your offsprings. It means they came out from you. And because they came out from you, they have your bloodline in them. They have your spirit in them. They have certain personality that is in you in them. No matter how far you want to deny it, they have similarity with you. Some of them talk like you. Some of them act like you. Some of them behave like you. But they are you. God has caused us to become his own product. If you are a product of God, how will your life be? Since you are now a product of God, how will you behave? Since you are now a product of God, oh my God, I want you to get that teaching this morning. Go to the book of Acts, chapter 17. Acts, chapter 17, quickly this morning. I want to share something with you. There's scripture that, boy, I've been thinking about this scripture. It just jumped into my spirit. I just go, whoa, 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 what is he talking about? Acts chapter 17. Acts 17. Look at verse 27 and verse 28. In fact, you want to start reading from verse 26. Because that would do us a great thing. Let's read from verse 24. 24 will be, Who are you? Do you know who you are? Do you know the abilities you possess? You see, religion will try to enslave you. All religion tries to do, it's trying to enslave mankind. Do you know that in certain churches, certain denominations, they don't allow you to read your Bible? They allow only the priest to read your Bible. A friend of mine told me once, said he was a mass boy at a church. And they refused him to read the Bible. In fact, some of the Catholic churches, the Catholic Church don't want you to read your Bible. They don't allow the members to read the Bible. It is the father that read the Bible. And this pastor friend of mine was growing up to be a priest. And he was in a mass boy. And one day he came and asked the father, is that he started reading the Bible. The father screamed at him and says, what? Don't read the Bible. It's going to make you go mad. Don't read the Bible. Don't read the Bible. Do you know that certain Christians were persecuted? Tyndale was killed for translating the Bible into English. He ran to Germany. They went and fetched him there. I mean, because you know, they didn't want the masses to get hold of the Word of God. Said, no, boy, you're giving people too much power if they get into the Word of God. It hasn't changed up to now. You cannot discover who you really are outside the manual of operation. You cannot know who you really are outside of what the Creator has created you to become. That's why the Bible says, my people are destroyed for the lack of knowledge. It didn't say the people of God are destroyed because the devil or witches or wizards are powerful. No. There is still no witch or wizard in this world that can destroy me. Why? Because I'm born of God. As long as I know Jesus Christ, as long as I remain in Jesus Christ, I am safe. But if I go outside to live in sin, then the least spirit in the world can destroy me. The least human being can destroy me because you are no longer an offspring of God. Once you are an offspring of God, there is no witch doctor. There's no demon in the pit of hell that can destroy you, because they can't destroy God. As long as you are an offspring of God, you are from God's root. You look like God. You behave like God. You walk with God. You talk like God. You live like God. Then you are a true manifestation of the offspring of God. Esau, though physically, biologically, was an offspring of Isaac, he did not live like Isaac. He did not operate like Isaac. Isaac was not a hunter. Isaac never went to hunt for food. Esau was a hunter. He did not manifest the covenant of the offspring. So God says, no, this guy is always wanting to have things done his own way. He always wants to be different in his own way. He wants to make things happen in his own way. He wants to do things apart from God's will. Whenever you become an Esau, you want to do things out of your own way. It has to be your will. You don't want God's will. If God tells you what he wants, you don't want to do it. It has to be what you want to do, and yet you want to receive the blessings of God. It cannot work. He says, Esau, I hate. Esau, I hate. Jacob, I love. Why? Because Jacob conforms to the Creator's rule. Jacob conforms to... Oh my God. So which of them are you? Are you an Esau believer or you are a Jacob believer? Are you a real offspring of God or you are an offspring of your earthly father, the man that raised you up than God? Because there are two kinds of father you have. It's the same thing. It's either you are going to live for God and God alone and manifest the reality of God by the word of God and conform your life with God's word, or you're going to conform to man's standard, man's rule, man's wisdom, man's imagination, man's character, and then you are outside the blessings of God. Let's read Acts chapter 17, verse 24. God that made the world and all things therein, the Creator, saying that he is Lord of heaven and earth, dwelleth not in the temples made with hands, neither is he worshipped with man's hands, as though he needed anything. My God. Saying that he is Lord of heaven and earth, dwelleth not in temples made with hands, neither is he worshipped with man's hands, as though he needed anything, seeing he giveth to all life. Look at that. Seeing he giveth to all life. Now, hear me. There's a life that comes from God. And breath. And breath. And all things. You know that? Hear me. He giveth to all life. He giveth to all life. And breath. And all things. I want you to understand that. All things. God gives all things. Someone tells you, God gives life. He gives breath. He gives life. He gives all things. There are three dimensions of existence. There's breath. First of all, there's life. There's breath. All things necessary, all things empowering, all things you need, the things you need to become exactly like God on the earth, the abilities, the wisdom, the know-how, the strength to take you to becoming that level of God. Thank God. 26. and hath made of one blood all nations of men for to dwell on all the face of the earth, and hath determined, hear the word, determined the times before appointed. The times before appointed. My God, I really want you to look into this in a deeper way this morning. The times before appointed and the bounds of their habitation, the bounds of their habitation, their territory, what they should do with their life, what they should conform to, what they should become, that they should seek the Lord. For if happily they might feel after him and find him, though he be not far from every one of us. Jesus. Say to yourself, God is near me. I want you to begin to praise God first of all before we continue. Say, Lord, I thank you that by your blood you are nearer me than before. God, you are near me. God is near. It says, God is near us. God is nigh me. God is nearer to me. Father, I'm praising you because you are near me. My God, you are near me. My God, you are nearer to me. I have God for my help. I have the Creator as my source. I have the Creator as my design. I have the Creator as my hope. I have the Creator as my rock. I have the Creator. I have everything about the Creator around me. I'm surrounded by the mercy of the Creator. I walk with the Creator. Woo! My God, Dan Brooks, so kento boshi kalamandi. Eh, la bobosh andaba. You are with the Creator. When you are with the Creator, infirmity cannot plague your life. Destruction cannot ruin you. No oracle can afflict you because you are working with the Creator. You are closer to the Creator. For in him, my God, don't look at verse 28. For in him we live. For in him I live. Begin to confess this word. My God, I live in you. I exist because of you. I have the breath of God in me. I have the words of God in me. Now you see why when I say a thing, it comes to pass. I have God in me. I live in God. Father, I give you praise and honor. You are my Creator. I am your creation. I am part of your being. I am part of your deity. I am covenanted with you, O God. I live for you. Your words give me life. In you I live. In him I live. I exist by you. I exist because of you. I am alive because of you. I have your life in me. My entirety is of you. Oh my God. Somebody begin to prophesy that word. I live in you, O God. I live by you, O God. I live from you. You are my source. You are my source. So why are you afraid? There's no need to be afraid. There's no room for fear in your life. There's no chance for fear in your life. There's no chance for fear. There can't be fear in you. What are you afraid of? It can't be in you. What is that report are you believing for? It can't be in you. What can man do to you? You are above the reach of man. You are above the reproach of man. You are above the conurbation of any power. There's no power that can rule over your destiny except you don't know who you are. But you are of God. You see, knowledge is the principal thing. God never said, my people are so powerless because the darkness is greater. My people are defeated. Oh, my people are not, I can't do anything with them because, no, God never said so. He said, it's the knowledge you have. My people are destroyed for the lack of knowledge. They are destroyed because they don't know who they are. They are destroyed because they've got their priorities messed up. They are distraught because they cannot understand the times and seasons they are in. They are distraught because they don't know how to defeat the enemy. They are distraught because they deny their rights. Now hear me. For in him we live. There's a life we have in him. When you come to Jesus, there's a life in you. You are not coming to Jesus to be going through cycles of defeat, oppression, and chaos, and you are always drowning. You are always in the place of help. You're in the place of confusion. Oh, you are helpless. Well, before you came to God, you could handle things. But now you're a child of God. You don't know why you can't handle things. Oh, blah, 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 blah. My life. Oh, no, 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 no. You are in charge. In every situation, you have control. In every situation, you can say, stop it now. It can't go more than this. I refuse to betray. I refuse to take this. No, stop, stop. Satan, you can't cross this. Hey, fellow, stop this right now. Hey, fellow, stop this. This is not real. I refuse to take this from you. You tell the devil, I've had enough. I've had enough of this, all right? You are a thief. You're stealing from me. You have no part in my destiny. Now, you can rebuke the devourer. He says you will resist the devil and he will flee from you. You see, all you need to manifest your creator nature is the word of God. All you need to become God on this earth, as I am manifesting God on this earth, is the word of God. I didn't say you not go through suffering. If Jesus went through suffering, you're going to go through suffering. But yet, the suffering did not defeat him. He took control. He gained the upper hand. Whenever you have the knowledge of the word of God, it repositions your destiny. You see reality so different from the masses out there. For in him, Acts 17:28, for in him we live and move. I live, I move, I exist, I hear, I do. I don't do anything because I want to do it. I do what God says I should do. I listen to him. And if God says stop, take a new turn, I must follow him. I must do what God asks. I move. I make decisions based on God's rule, on God's leading. In him we live and move and have our being. In him we live, we move and have our being. We have, I exist in him. My whole existence, your whole existence has to be. Why is that so? Because we are his offspring. Boy, did you get that? Because we are his offspring. I'm not a friend of God. I'm a child of God. I'm not a servant of God. I'm a son of God. Now, there's a great difference there. Why? Because I'm an offspring of God. You are an offspring of God. And because you are an offspring of God, there should be nothing that can limit you. There should be nothing that can defeat you. There should be nothing that, oh, nebro si kababa. Is somebody hear what I'm saying this morning? For we live and move and have our being, as certain also of your own poet have said, for we are also his offspring. We are also his offspring. We are also his offspring. We are the offspring of God. We are in a covenant with God. Now, how do you become an offspring of God? By being born again. By how? Born again by the word of God. You live by the word of God. You are not born of matter. You are not born of flesh and blood. But you have been born of God. And because the book of John 1 says, he that is born of God overcomes the world. And we are born of God. Therefore, we have the power. John 1 says, we have the power to become sons of God. Now, we are now offsprings of God. You are going to begin to declare and declare this morning, I am God's property. I am a child of God. Every rod of wickedness resting on my head, the Lord rebuke you. Every rod of injustice plaguing me, I resist your effect over my life. Every power from the gates of hell assigned to destroy my life, the Lord Jesus rebuke you. I am a product of the Creator. You are a creation problem. Therefore, you must be solved today. In my life, wherever you have taken claim, wherever you have laid hold, I resist your rule. I resist your rule. I denounce the works of darkness in my mind. Somebody pray with me this morning. I want you to pray. Open your mind and begin to decree and declare. Begin to decree and declare your rightship. You are a product of God. You belong to Jesus. That sickness has to go. That sickness has to go. That sickness has to go. That migraine has to go. That barrenness has to go. That failure has to go. That defeat has to go. That shame has to go. That disgrace has to go. You are a child of God by the blood of Jesus. You are in the nature of God. You are an offspring of God. You are a product by design. You are not a product of mistake and chance. Therefore, every power from the pit of hell assigned to confuse your mind, assigned to crowd your imagination, assigned to weaken you, assigned to paralyze your product, or to paralyze your progress, I bind it on the earth because we are the offspring of God, created in the image of God. We have the life of God in us. We have the word of God in us. We have the power of God in us. We are like Him. We are like God. Oh my gosh. It says, as it is, so are we in this world. As Jesus was on the face of the earth, so are we. As Jesus was on the face of the earth, so are we. As Jesus. Mande brondo brigala baba sunte. Zoka bondo brigalo bobo sunda. Bazo go bondo brigula baba shinda. Iba baba soto brigala baba sunte. Mayi konto ni brogida baba sunde. Robo bobo bobo bo. Robo bobo bobo bo. Robo bobo bobo bo. Robo bo kandele de shinda ba. We declare and declare by the power of the Holy Ghost. Mayi kando bre kondo she. We bind on the earth. We bind on the earth. We bind every lies of the devil that has taken grip over your mind. We pull it down this morning by the blood of Jesus. Every false hold, I said every wicked imagination assigned to plague you, assigned to deceive you of your birthright, we render that power powerless. We bind your work on the earth. We say, let go of the children of God. I said, let go of God's children. I come against every cloud of depression. Right now, hovering over your life, every cloud of depression right now, hovering over your life, I rebuke the devourer. I rebuke the devourer. We are God's offspring. You know what to do with your life. You are no longer bound by confusion. Oh, Pastor, I don't know what to do. No, you have the mind of Christ. The Bible says that you have the mind of Christ. You have the wisdom of God. You have the ability of God. You have the power of God, and you can do more than you can imagine. You are equipped to take advantage of situation today. Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Le prosom to brendo brigando lo bobo shindaba. Maso le punto pre kulaba sende kronde bosh laba. Oli baba 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 basso. La baba so le bundo pricando de prosonda meki. Magando ne brocande prosita madi. Ori baba baba shanda le pronto presunta. Iantono brosi. By the blood of Jesus, we are the offspring of God. My God, we are the offspring of God. As a result, we have the mind of Christ. As a result, we have the ability of God. My God. Look at verse 29. Acts chapter 17, verse 29. For as much then, Some translation says, therefore. Now, listen, listen. For as much then as we are the offspring of God, we ought not to think that the Godhead is like unto gold or silver or stone or graven by art and man's device. My God. I love this word. Powerful word. Jesus. You did not create God. You cannot create God. It's trying to tell them, God is not a creation of your imagination. Because they were an idol community there, worshipping idols made by the hands of men and blacksmith, all kinds of false god. And Paul is saying them, say, listen, folks, if we are God's product, then we are not the one that created God. God created you. Therefore, since you and I, we are offspring of God, what can we do on the earth? Well, we can do whatever God does. We can do whatever we hear God doing. We can do whatever we've heard in the Bible. Folks, I'm presenting to you a fact that by the word of God, we've been born again. That by the word of God, you have authority over your situation. I'm presenting to you a fact that by the word of God, you have dominion over every power and principalities. That by the word of God, you can get out of every slump situation you find yourself. You can rise up and accomplish great things. You can rise up and take custody of your life. Because why? You are born of God. You are in charge. Your circumstance is not in charge. Take control from that problem. Take authority from the hand of that situation. Strip that problem bare. Take dominion from that hands of that problem that you are seeing. Take authority over that situation. Take authority over that problem. You can do it. Take authority over that challenge. Take authority over that difficulty. You can do it. Take authority over it. Glory to God. Yeah. My God. Speak to that mountain. We as offspring of God, we speak to situation. We speak to mountains. They hear us. We speak to problems and they obey. We speak to powers and they submit. Why? Because we are born of God. We are the offspring. You have the power. Don't say, Pastor, no, maybe. No. You, except you believe that you are not born of God. But if you are born of God, he that is born of God overcomes the world. You are in charge. Your problem is not in charge. Your challenge is not in charge. The doctor's report is not in charge. The bankers are not in charge. We are in charge of destiny. By the blood of Jesus, I decree and declare this morning that the power of God's word become effective in your life. That you know that you are born of God. And because you are born of God, you have the mind of Christ. And because you have the mind of Christ, you can do all things through Christ Jesus who strengthens you. You can do it. I can do all things through Christ Jesus. I can go on. I can make it. I can be established by the word of God. I can live a life of obedience and holiness.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Le brosonda breku liba baba sande. Mazi gondo brekando boshida baba hondo. Baka yika bando breku labase. Mando bento bondo brigada baba junde. Mazo bondo brego leba baba shonda. Zeko bondo breko liba baba sute. Baka yika banda brigala baba zonde. I ribroso ti brakoto brigi. Maso brigando bregundo brinde. Maso grinda brondo brigando bri. Gedo brondo brigando brigolosi. Maso gonto hedere. Every stormy block on your pathway, I command it to be split now. Every delay, desist your hold. In the name of the Lord Jesus, we speak as offspring of God. How do offspring of God behave? They behave like God. You behave like God. How do you behave like God? By the word of God, the Bible, the promises of God that has given you life. You speak those words of God out. Faith-filled promises of God. You stand on God's word and you rebuke the devourer. You keep on rebuking the devourer until the devourer knows your voice, that this is an offspring of God. Hallelujah. It is written, he that is born of God, I say it again, overcomes the world. Yes, and God. This is our victory. This is the faith of victory, the power, the anointing that overcomes the devil and the world and wickedness. Even your faith, even your faith, even that which is of faith, what you believe to be as of God, what you stand upon. My God, wipe those tears away, baby. Wipe those tears away, daughter of God, son of God. Stop being helpless. You are not helpless. You are not hopeless. We are in charge. You are in charge over that situation. The wisdom of God is profitable to you in that situation, in that circumstances. You are born of God. God is never held ransom. You can't hold God hostage. Therefore, nobody can hold you hostage. Hear me? You are born of God. No situation, no economic situation can hold you hostage. No economic embargo will work on you. By the blood of Jesus, begin to pray. We break every embargo placed on you. We break it this morning. I break every satanic embargo put in over your life. My God, I'm an offspring of God. 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 Ne punto de pusanda. Mando li prondo shida. Maso kinda brondo brendi. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Blessed be your name, O God. My God,